An alcoholic drink brewed from rice and water, sake is quintessentially Japanese. But with its rich flavor refined over centuries by skilled brewers, it has recently achieved worldwide popularity. Sake brewers create that flavor using traditional techniques that date back to the 17th century. The master brewer is in charge of brewing, and Philip Harper is the only foreign master sake brewer in the whole of Japan. Harper has been involved in sake brewing for 20 years. His quest is to produce the ultimate sake. He uses every ounce of his skill to make the sake he sees in his mind's eye a reality. Harper sake is known for its fruity bouquets and for how it captures the sweetness of rice. It has won the top prize at Japan's National New Sake Connoisseur Contest. Today we'll meet the British-born master sake brewer Philip Harper and learn about his methods and determination.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today we present another in our series of Japanophiles, and the Japanophile I've come to see here in Kyotango, which is a fairly remote part of central Japan on the coast of the Sea of Japan, is Philip Harper, who is a sake brewer. This area is well known for the quality of its rice and also for copious natural water that flows down from the surrounding mountains out of melted snow. And with both rice and water, you can imagine there's lots of sake breweries too. Hello.
Hi. Hi, how do you do?
We finally got here.
Welcome, through the snow.
Good to see you. I'm looking forward to this one. I'm a big sake fan.
Great, so. All right. Do you want to see the brewery then?
Sure, great.
Okay. So this is the fermentation room. This is where we do the mashing and the main fermentation phase.
Mm, it's that distinctive aroma you get from brewing sake, don't you?
There's fermenting sake in the tanks up here. In a moment we'll go upstairs and you can have a look at the stuff actually bubbling and seething away.
This season, Harper's Brewery is fermenting 120,000 litres of sake in 54 tanks.
Right. And the owner's family have been kicking around this. So this we mashed this yesterday, and it's still very stiff at this stage. You can just see the yeast starting to bubble up through the cracks
there
as it begins. You can still see, basically rice particles up there, so it's still very stiff and not liquid at this point. And 2 days later, it would look like this, so this is 2 days further on. And the foam now has covered the whole surface of the mash there, and you can't see any of the grains of rice anymore.
I was going to say, you don't see
anymore.
The bubbling.
No, it's all covered with this foam now.
Right.
And that one over there, that's on day six now, so the foam is almost at its peak now.
Uh-huh.
And that funny little machine whirring away there's to stop the foam actually overflowing out of the out of the vat.
Uh-huh.
And you can just see here, the yeast is just starting to bowl up through the cracks here. This is just the beginning of fermentation.
Right. Right, you do get the impression of it being a sort of living thing, don't you?
Well, it's an awful lot of living things in there, in fact. Yeah. I mean, it's obviously yeast is microscopic, so you can't see it, but I mean, you do get this enormous amount of energy from the fermentation.
Mm.
Harper is the master brewer at a sake brewery that boasts a 170-year history. It's now late January. The high season for sake brewing is the dead of winter. It's the busiest time of year for Harper and the four people in his team. The first step in sake making is sprinkling spores of a special mold onto steamed rice. The mold grows on the rice to create koji, a cultured substance that plays a key role in creating the goodness and sweetness of sake. Now the mashing can begin. Steamed rice and water are mixed with the koji together with yeast. The koji converts the rice starch into sugars, and the yeast breaks down these sugars into alcohol. One challenge of sake brewing is that these two chemical reactions happen at the same time in the same tank. Also, this technique produces a beverage that is 20% alcohol or more. Sake is stronger than any other drink that's brewed. Philip Harper was born in 1966 in Cornwall, in the southwest of England. He encountered sake when he came to Japan to teach English. When he was 22, Harper was astonished by a sake that he drank at a Japanese pub. From that point on, sake became his life.
What have you got lined up for me to try here?
Well, I mean, we make lots of different styles, but I thought I'd give you three just to give you some idea of kind of the range of what we do.
Okay. Oh, you I can see the colour difference for a start. And I can see this one's going to be different again. Okay, wow.
So, colour gradation for a start.
Yeah.
And if you before you drink them, if you want to have a sniff of each one and see how different
start
they smell.
Start with here.
Yeah, start there, I should think.
Ooh. I wouldn't have even said that was sake, you know, if I just smelled that. Don't know what I would have said it is.
This is made from a 300-year-old recipe.
Ooh. That's almost like a sweet sherry or something, isn't it?
Well, wine people, they tend to come up with the Eiswein, with the very sweet German wines, or noble rot wines.
Mm. Yeah, or maybe a dessert wine almost.
Right,
yeah.
Right. That's the kind of that.
That's the first time I've had anything like that, but it's actually quite nice.
Yeah.
You might want to, I might want to have it after the meal rather than with the meal. I don't know.
That's right. Well, I mean, originally we made this to go with ice cream, which it does very well. But we've also discovered that it goes really well with really salty Japanese delicacies. Foie gras and a whole range of things. It's kind of an extreme sake, but it has a much wider range than I think you think from the first impression.
Yeah, very interesting, that one.
Next, our presenter tries a daiginjo. Daiginjo is made using a labour-intensive process in which the rice is polished down by at least 50%. The result is a clean, crisp flavour.
Mm. It's a very sort of robust daiginjo. I mean, daiginjo comes in all sorts of, well, as you know, varieties, but I like that, I must say. I'm not a daiginjo fan normally, actually. I tend to go for ones that are slightly less fruity, but that is very well balanced.
Thank you.
For me, anyway.
Down in the west of Japan, we tend to do things with a bit more punch.
Mm. You get sake in all different temperatures, don't you?
Yes, yeah. One of the great pleasures of sake drinking. Most of our customers who drink this would be drinking it cold, whereas I personally would almost never drink the one in the middle cold at all. I much prefer it warm.
Mm. How warm?
Well, there's warm and there's hot, and I mean, there's a whole range of expressions in Japanese to cover these.
Right.
From cold temperatures right up to very hot indeed.
How hot does it get at the hottest?
Well, the standard orthodox opinion is what's called atsukan, which is hot.
Right.
Is about 55 degrees.
Yeah.
And the very mildly warm version is called nurukan.
Or lukewarm.
Which doesn't sound very nice, but it's a really nice temperature to drink at.
A little higher than body temperature, probably.
Right. And I mean, if you take it right down to body temperature, there's a word for that, of course, hitohadakan, which means the temperature of people's skin.
Right.
And so there are all these lovely expressions to do it with as well. And playing around with temperature is really one of the great joys of sake. And we're so used to playing around with finding the sweet spot of a specific sake, which is a different temperature for every sake, of course.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Harper's brewing career began in 1991. 3 years after he came to Japan. He took a job at an old sake brewery in Nara Prefecture. There he learned the entire sake making process, from polishing and washing the rice to preparing the koji. Originally, sake was made by seasonal laborers. Farmers looking for work during their off season would be hired in groups at breweries. The most skilled among them would be given the job of leading the brewing process. They were called toji, or master brewers, a title that still exists. With long years of experience and well-honed instincts, master brewers direct the other workers in the making of good sake. Harper himself became a master brewer after 15 years of study. The brewery where Harper currently works hired him in 2006. It was a testament to his great skill.
Lots of people like to drink sake, but not all that many actually get into making it. Mm. What put you on that path?
Well, I became friends with these two young Japanese men, and they were keen on sake, so we started going out drinking sake together, and people were saying to us all the time that there's never been a better time to drink sake, that there are all these new exciting things going on, that we're at the culminating peak of 300 years of an artisan tradition. But that in those days, sake was almost all made by craftsmen from the traditional brewers' guilds.
Right.
But at the same time, the brewers' guilds were sort of reaching the point where they were unable to find young people to come in and take over and carry on the tradition. So there was a real manpower crisis in the industry. And so on the one hand, people were telling us that it was the best time ever to be drinking sake. And on the other hand, they were saying, but in another 10 years, there won't be anyone around with the skills to make this stuff. And so the people I first started working with were the youngest in the group was in his late 50s, and the average age of sake brewers even back then was about 60 or more.
So I mean, for somebody who's coming into Japan, not even really being familiar with this whole Japanese society, it must have been tough at times.
It wasn't an easy environment, and live and work in the brewery through the roughly 6 months of the brewing season. So it was you're on duty 24 hours a day, basically. And so the last session of communal work was at about 9 o'clock in the evening, and the next day started at 5:30 or 6 o'clock. So there's not time to watch a complete film on the TV in the 6 months of the brewing season.
Wow.
It has its own rules. In the master brewer reads the newspaper first, and he's the second in command. Reads, and everything from newspapers to bath time, it goes in order of seniority, which is certainly. I mean, it's an unfamiliar way of doing things to Westerners, but it has its own logic and its own rule. I have to say, I never really found it to be an enormously stressful thing. When you have really, really good sake coming out at the end, I mean, it's pretty easy to think that maybe this is not such a bad thing and we'll just get on with it.
Did you ever think that you would get to be a master brewer?
Well, no, because, I mean, partly, I mean, Japanese culture is not very keen on people blowing their own trumpet, I suppose. And so it's probably tactically not a good kind of thing to be saying. But even more realistically speaking, I mean, there are lots of brewers in a sake brewery, but there's only one toji, only one master brewer.
Right.
And not everyone who works in a brewery gets to be a master brewer, even if they want to. And so I had no way of knowing whether it was within my power to reach the level of skill that you need to be able to do that thing.
Mm. Is there a lot of pressure once you've stepped up?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I always found it quite a lot of pressure even before I stepped up.
Really?
I mean, yeah, and and as I say, all the processes of sake brewing, they fit together in very complicated ways. So, I mean, everyone in a brewery has a part to play, and if that doesn't all fit together, then however wonderful a master brewer you've got the time, if the whole thing doesn't mesh together, then nothing goes right. And my first... mentor, he used to say on sort of every other day, it seemed like that sake brewing is a matter of experience and sense, almost sixth sense.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And the other thing that he always used to say, and in this job it takes 10 years to learn the basics, and 20 years before you really know what's going on. So I'm just starting to sort of get the hang of it now.
Here is the koji room. Preparing koji puts the master brewer's skills to the test more than any other task. The koji room is kept at over 30 degrees Celsius, and humidity inside may reach 100%. It's almost like a sauna. Work here is usually done bare-chested. And the work begins with the cooling of freshly steamed rice. The key to creating a high-quality koji is the moisture content of the rice at the moment when the koji spores are sprinkled over it. To ensure that conditions are optimal for mold growth, the rice is kneaded to drive out excess water. Harper visits the Koji room frequently, even though the mashing process is going on at the same time. Brewing keeps him pretty busy. 30 minutes later, he judges that the rice is still too moist. He continues kneading the rice, helping it to dry. Now it's 3.5 hours after the rice was initially spread out. Harper makes his fourth check. When sufficient moisture has gone out of the rice, the sound it makes when it's kneaded changes.
音ですか？わかります。はい。結局だいぶさばけてきてますんで、表面が乾いてきてますんで、師匠はいつも大体さばけということは手触りのことを基本的に言うんですけど、師匠は五感のさばけといつも言ってましたね。手触りと味と、結局この音のさばけ方もそうですね。
The steamed rice has now been spread out for 6 hours. This is Harper's sixth check. Harper decides that the rice finally has the right moisture. Now he can sprinkle it with the koji mold spores. For this particular sake, 10 kilograms of rice gets just 1 gram of spores, a tiny amount. Until these spores have a chance to settle on the rice, the room is sealed, airtight. The brewers mustn't move at all. After 1 minute, at Harper's signal, vents in the ceiling are open. Now the rice is kneaded to evenly distribute the spores through it. There are many more tasks that follow. Spore-bearing rice is very delicate. This rice is gathered up and wrapped in a cloth in order to keep any other small organisms from contaminating it. The bundled rice is left to sit overnight. It's kept at 30 degrees Celsius. The optimal temperature for the mold to grow. The next morning, the mold has indeed begun to grow on the rice. The mold-bearing rice is divided into smaller boxes. This gives the brewers greater control over its temperature. The mold is sensitive. It will stop growing if the temperature drops, and it will die if the temperature gets too high. So it's essential to keep track of even the slightest variation in temperature. If the rice begins warming up, wooden slats are inserted beneath the box to improve airflow. These kinds of minute adjustments are made again and again. Harper's full attention is focused on the feel and smell. He wants the mold to grow slowly but surely. It's now 48 hours since the rice was first brought to the koji room. The koji is ready at last.
相手が微生物で、生き物ですんで、その機械的なものと付き合うのとは若干違うと思いますね。生き物なんで、そのつもりで付き合わないとうまくいかないですね。
It's incredibly labor-intensive, isn't it?
In the scenes that you saw there, the temperature in the room is taken up to 40 degrees centigrade, which is plenty hot.
Yeah, really.
And then when you come out, then you're down to about 2 or 3 centigrade in the rest of the brewery. So it's a fairly extreme sort of environment that you spend your day pottering around in.
When you were sprinkling the koji,
yeah.
It was like everybody had practically stopped breathing.
Yes, yeah.
Now, what was that all about?
If I could actually get them to stop breathing, that's what I would prefer to happen.
But, really?
Yeah. And the reason is that, that sort of funny thing I'm doing there with the can is it, there are spores of the mold in there. And if you have people sort of laughing or sneezing or giggling in there, they fly all over the place and you don't know where they're going.
Oh, my God.
So we have this sort of peculiar couple of minutes after each round where everyone is there hoping that they don't sneeze. And because the actual operatives are not so much people as microorganisms, you have to do things at the pace of the microorganisms. Which doesn't always not always the most comfortable pace for people to be involved with.
And what we saw you doing there was just that's just one part of the process, yeah. Right? Fairly early on.
Yes. Yeah.
And there's a whole number of different things that go on after that, right?
And before, yeah. I mean,
and before you, as well.
Have,
okay.
you have to polish the rice first of all, then wash it and steam it before you even get to the Koji room. And then there are sort of various stages of propagating yeast and mashing and pressing and all these other bits and pieces that you all have to fit in together.
How many different types of sake do you make altogether?
Well, if in sort of basic style terms, we do about 15 different things here. This is the brewing schedule for January. So if you look at this, I mean, you can see some of the things that are going on here. What we have down here, these different colours, they're all different varieties of rice.
Oh, okay.
And for one of the most famous rice varieties is Yamada Nishiki, this one here.
Yep.
And you can see this Yamada Nishiki 40%. So this is the figure that remains of the grain after we've polished. Mm. So we have different products which are made from the same variety of rice, but a different degree of polish will give you a different finished product. Mm. And we actually bottle limited editions from each of those when we first press them as well. So if you sort of start listing it all up, it gets into three figures quite comfortably.
Over 100?
Yes, yeah.
Out of interest, do you use all locally grown rice?
This is made with organic rice, which is actually grown in the next township, where this splendid bird, which is the great white oriental stork, where it's an endangered species and it lives there. It's this huge carnivorous bird. And so if you use a lot of agricultural chemicals in the field, then you have fewer newts and frogs and things, which are the food for the birds. And
okay.
so we use organically grown rice from there and make a donation from each bottle to help protect the stork's environment, which is a really nice thing to be able to do.
Mm.
The whole business of sake brewing is, as I say, it's a very agricultural business.
What for you is like the key to what makes good sake?
It's very important for people to work together, just in terms of obvious conventional teamwork. And it sounds kind of philosophical to be talking about harmony as an element of successful brewing, but it's frightening to see how if you do get friction between the brewers, then the sake that comes out tends to reflect that, sadly.
Interesting.
Here we go.
Harper has chosen a sake to share with our presenter. This particular one tastes quite different at different temperatures, and they'll taste that difference for themselves.
Of course, we're supposed to pour each other's,
yeah,
aren't we?
Yeah, we better do it properly.
Let's do that, shall we?
All right. Thank you.
There we go.
Cheers.
Okay. Cheers. It kind of releases the flavour in a slightly different way when it's warm. It still has the same punch, but there's a kind of softness as well.
It's kind of
hard to explain.
No, I think you're right on the money. I mean, that's what it does for me is it softens out. It makes the whole thing a lot. It's still the same sake, as you say. It still has a fair punch to it, but you get all this sort of gentle warmth coming up from it.
Mm. Why did you choose to drink this one now?
The main thing was that it's this time of year when it's cold, so I wanted something hot.
Okay.
Even the same sake works in different ways over a different range of temperatures. And the other thing is that sake is so good with food.
So, for example, with this sake, what kind of non-Japanese food do you think this would go well with?
Well, it's a fairly robust flavoured sake. So, I mean, it'll go really well with cooked meats, grilled meats and that kind of thing. Mm. I'm really fond of this kind of slightly earthy sake with anything with mushrooms in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's great with cheese as well.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Sake is not a drink that a lot of young Japanese go for these days, unfortunately,
yeah.
I think. Is there anything that you think you can do to help change that?
Well, I mean, I think one of the great joys of sake is that you can drink it in so many different ways. And I think the images of sake tend to be very limited. Mm. The big thing is to find a way into a room with a load of people who think they don't like sake and actually get them to sit down and drink it. And so we're doing all these things to show people what is the enormous range of sake and what the possibilities are and how many different ways there are to have fun with it.
Mm.
Yeah, I think if you give me a room with 100 people who say they don't like sake, I have every confidence that I can send 90 of them home thinking that maybe they do after all.
Right. The last question, what to you is Japan?
Yeah. There's this verb in Japanese to means to go home, kaeru.
Uh-huh.
And in a Japanese context, when you go home to the place that your family originally came from, then this is called going home to the original birthplace of the family, a sato gairi, going home.
Uh-huh.
And so, of course, when I go home to the UK, that's what I'm doing. I'm going home to the ancestral home. And after I've been in Japan for a few years, I found myself struggling with talking to Japanese friends and colleagues because I found myself having to use this verb to go home in two directions, which is not really very logical.
Uh-huh.
And so I suppose at some point, quite a long time ago now, Japan ceased to be another place and became one of the two places I go home to.
Thank you very much.
A day's work has ended. Harper and his workers play a sake tasting game. The varieties they are tasting include one from a different brewery. They have to figure out which it is. The men take this game very seriously, but one of them guesses wrong. Harper has spent the last 20 years in the sake brewing trade. He and his team of four work in harmony, focused on the goal of creating the ultimate Japanese sake. Next time on Begin Japanology, Kabuki. With its stunning costumes and striking makeup, Kabuki is uniquely beautiful and entertains in countless different ways. We'll see what it reveals about the Japanese sense of beauty.